ensure that the chairs up front are also occupied. Hope you all had a sumptuous lunch. We're going to have some invigorating sessions, and I'm sure that all of us need to be wide awake. Ladies and gentlemen, kindly do settle down. Once again, may I remind you to please place your cell phones and your electronic devices to the silent mode if you haven't already. Thank you. I'll just give you a moment to settle down, and then we shall begin right away. Okay, so the next session that we're going to witness has the topic, how do you bridge ancient wisdom and modern knowledge? A very appropriate topic for our times. We have our speakers right here with us. Would you greet them with a warm round of applause? We have Dr. Sudha Seshayyan, Vice Principal, Madras Medical College, Reverend Valson Thampu, former Principal St. Stephen's College, and our chairperson for this panel discussion, Ms. Mani Rao, author, poet, and scholar. Please do join us on stage. Once again, very quickly, let me just remind the panel and the audience that the chairperson begins, and she will express her views on the topic. And then we'll hand over the stage to each of the speakers, who will then try and express their views within the given time, which is about 8 to 9 minutes, post which there will be a group discussion amongst them. And right at the end, there will be a quick Q&A with the audience. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, and namaste to all of you. So very happy to be here, and thank you so much to Indian Express for organizing this. It's been a very interesting day and a half. Our topic is how to bridge ancient wisdom and modern knowledge. Now, that sounds like a marketing question. More than that, it is more than that. It's not only a marketing question, of course. So that we are actually here to discuss how to bridge ancient wisdom, modern knowledge means that there must be some kind of gap to bridge. So I'm going to begin with that assumption. Whether that's real or theoretical, we'll see. And I'll share what I think about that. My first solution actually comes from the topic. See how within the very topic you have ancient wisdom paired together and modern knowledge paired together. The suggestion being that what is ancient is wise and what is modern is knowledge, or what is ancient is not knowledge and what is modern is not wise. In that very pairing, you actually have two different things, and I will call it romance and prejudice, both. So my first solution is suspend romance and prejudice, both. I've actually met young students who are passionate and fervent about wanting to, for example, live the Vedic life, but they don't actually know what that might mean or how they might even begin to do that. On the other hand, I've actually met people who have preconceived notions about ancient sources without actually bothering to learn about them. Neither should we reject and denigrate something because it is ancient, nor should we revere and romanticize it because it is ancient. First, we need to try to know what we are bridging. We need to first become informed. And of course, for this, we have to have or find access. This leads to some very obvious points. It means language studies. It means investing in libraries, frankly. Some of our best libraries are embarrassingly unkempt. And if scholars study Indology in Europe and USA, let's try to understand why that is so. I would also say it points to a need for and a respect for anthropology, cultural studies, ethnography, because in particular in India, it's not only the canonized sources that contain wisdom, it is the people. Anybody who has traveled by road in India knows many eras exist at once, and not only because of tourism. Second, we need to focus on the information rather than what it means about us. Then we're liberated from predeterminations that come from all kinds of platforms, all sorts of platforms, including those of identity, civilizational, cultural, religious, a number of pieties. When we focus on the information rather than what it means about the learners, we break through packaging and boxes. We find out that not everyone who studies Sanskrit or believes in Ishvara is right, nor is everyone else left. When we focus on the information rather than what it means about the learners, we also become sensitive to context. This means that we recognize we live in a society that is different from that many centuries or millennia ago. Equal opportunities in education and roles for men and women mean that we cannot just simply graft something taken from the past onto the present. We cannot go back. We do not have to duplicate it. But becoming informed, we become more self-aware. Just because you're not happy with the ending of the Ramayana or with what happens to Sita, you don't have to reject it. You don't have to reject a rich resource because of a small thing you don't feel comfortable with. Third, you know the saying, you can take a horse to the water, but you can't make it drink it. No matter how much propaganda you use, you only promote platforms, conventions, modes of behavior, respect, reverence, and so on. What finally bridges the gap between ancient wisdom and modern knowledge is experience. It's the taste. There's a story about a lion cub that's among a bunch of sheep. One day a lion shows up and recognizes this lion cub. So the lion says, "Hey, you're a lion." And the lion cub says, "No, I'm scared. I'm not a lion." Anyway, the story ends like this. The lion cub goes for a hunt, has a taste of the kill, and then discovers that he is a lion, you know? That's when he realizes who he is. That is what I most believe in, that when there is experience, there is immediacy, and there is neither ancient nor modern. In fact, both ancient and modern are both present. At any point in time, people always live in the present. In the prelude to the Sanskrit play Malavikagnimitram, the Sutradhar, the presenter, tells the assistant that a new play by Kalidasa should be staged for the spring festival. The assistant replies, "How can we disregard Bhasa, Saumila, and Kaviputra and choose a composition by Kalidasa, a contemporary poet?" The phrase used is Vartamana Kavi. Ancient and modern are both present. You and I might think Kalidasa is classic. Kalidasa thought of himself as a modern poet. So this is also my own approach. Whether to Kalidasa or to Ezra Pound, if you engage with a subject, all that there is immediacy. Fourthly, having said that, the frameworks of ancient knowledge and modern wisdom are different. The problem occurs when you try to apply one onto the other. In my doctoral work on mantra, I met a number of people who are conducting experiments, for instance, to prove that Medha Suktam increases intelligence, mental capacity, and so on. That's just an example. But all of this, in fact, is in the service of the parameters of modern science and the desire to be accepted by it. For sure, there are parameters in early Indic thought. Indian philosophies accept the following criteria as evidence in varied combinations: pratyaksha, perception; anumana, inference; upamana, comparison; anupalabdha, non-apprehension; arthapatti, postulation; shabda, especially Veda Tantra. But these are not the parameters of modern knowledge, which is primarily based on perception. So the answer is, in order to bridge the ancient and modern, we have to recognize the difference also. With those comments, I would love to hand over to my fellow panelists. Valson, could you? Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's great to be here. I'm grateful to the chairperson for having deconstructed the topic very comprehensively, and therefore I will not go into any of those. I'll start with a couple of very preliminary comments on the topic itself to suggest a different direction. The topic assumes that, or takes it for granted, that a bridge needs to be built. So that's the given. It therefore assumes that there is a discontinuity, a break. And it also assumes that a bridge needs to be built. I would want to first of all argue that the bridge image is not a very helpful one. If you're talking about knowledge and wisdom, then actually you must talk about integration, because knowledge and wisdom are by definition continuous with each other. There cannot be a discontinuity between the two. What has happened is that because of certain cultural pressures, they have parted company only for the time being. And I think it's an important intellectual and spiritual duty at any given point in time to bring them together, to make them integrate, so that human beings experience what is called wholeness. I'll come to that a little later. The second thing I want to say, and I'll be very brief and jerky for want of time, I think the most important thing for a subject like this in the public space is to define the terms. If you don't define the terms, you actually don't reach anywhere. I remember Voltaire saying, if you wish to have a conversation with me, you must first define the terms. What does knowledge mean? What does wisdom mean? And for what purpose, to what end should they be integrated? And we have to look at these things in the specific context in which we are. And that context, globally, is a way of life which is completely dominated by technology. Now, technology is the result of knowledge. Techne in Greek means skill. The skillful use of knowledge is technology. But there's no problem there. But the problem arises when this knowledge is posited within a cultural model or cultural paradigm which defines knowledge exclusively in terms of power. Knowledge is power. And power very soon becomes profit. And therefore you have knowledge giving birth to an acquisitive society, an acquisitive orientation to human life and nature. And this is the fundamental problem, because the acquisitive orientation is essentially reductionist. A person who acquires, who only wants to receive, continues to shrink and shrivel. Ultimately, he becomes a caricature of a human being. What about wisdom? Wisdom is also knowledge. We talk about ancient wisdom, forgetting the fact that at that time when this wisdom was generated, it was also knowledge. Vedas are knowledge. But today, distanced in time, we believe that it is wisdom because we have pushed it aside beyond the boundaries of our active life and consciousness. Now, wisdom, let's say, for sake of argument, is if knowledge is know-how, wisdom is know-why. You know, Socrates, following him, Plato, Aristotle, all of them said the most fundamental question to ask is why? Why? And why pertains to the purpose. So you have today a lot of knowledge generated, warehoused, packaged, sold. But if you ask people the purpose behind all this, you run into a problem. So, looking at it now, my background is academics, and I'm now going to confine myself entirely to academics. Looking at it from an academic perspective, the question arises, I have no disagreement with the assumption in the topic that wisdom and knowledge must be integrated. Let me state my position very clearly. The question arises, how do we actually do this? Now, this question cannot be discussed without identifying the motive for such an exercise. All of us know that in India, the track record for implementing everything is very poor. The main reason is that we never really identify, spell out the purpose, the motive. Why should we be doing this? Is always left vague. As a result, a track record of realizing any goal, and if you look at the literature pertaining to education, all the Education Commission reports, including the 2016 National Policy on Education document, you find one thing very clearly, that every goal prescribed for education, every stated intention has been forgotten. That is our track record. And the same thing can happen to this also, particularly given the fact that we are living in a technology-intensive way of life where there is absolutely no patience with wisdom. In fact, wisdom is considered a liability of sorts. So therefore, we need to actually identify for ourselves a purpose, a motive for this. And I'm going to suggest a motive which is purely pedagogic, educational, more educational than pedagogic. Here, let me go back in time. Let's go back to the ancient Indian idea of education. It's a grand theme in itself. Let me just very quickly flag 1, 2, 3, and then take up just one for want of time. The shaping purpose of education or the pursuit of education or learning in our ancient system was the complete realization of the self. This is extremely important. If wisdom is to be brought back on table, we have to actually be willing to undertake a revolution in the understanding and practice of education. Education as it is practiced has nothing to do with the realization of the self. Now, if you read somebody like Will Durant or say Oscar Wilde, they will all tell you that today we don't have individuals. In fact, Will Durant goes to the extent of saying that every human being is a crowd. There is no integration, there is no consistency, there is no coherence in human personality. The reason is we don't understand ourselves. I find it very funny that people are willing to fight and shed blood on the question of identity. But people are simply not bothered about the integrity of the self. Who are you in the final analysis? Nobody has an answer to it. And I blame the Indian the education system that we are pursuing. Let me ask you a question. What will you do with all your knowledge if you are a stranger to yourself? How will you live in this world? It's extremely important for us, and that's where we began. And that's the wisdom we lost along the way. As T.S. Eliot asks in his chorus in the rocks, he said, where is the knowledge we have lost because of our information, and where is the wisdom we have lost because of our knowledge? So, how do we understand the self? Now, at this point in time, let me come to our education itself as we understand it. Some 20 years ago, we renamed education as human resource development. But nothing changed. Just the name changed. The funniest thing about human resource development is that there is absolutely no emphasis on the word human. You go to the UGC, you will find a section on value education. And I happened to go and talk to the person posted there, and she told me this is punishment posting. I'm not allowed to do anything. So this is our problem. Now, from the ancient point of view, we are not educating people at all. We have embraced the Western model because of the certain perceived advantages it confers on us, and therefore we have forgotten the idea that we need to be human. Now, of course, a great deal of excitement is now created about creating digital India. I'm not in any disagreement with digital India. But the digital India must be inhabited by human beings. We must create a humane society, a sane society, a just and fair society. How do you do that? Where do you begin that? So therefore, we must understand human resource development completely, radically, differently from what we have done so far. Otherwise, there is absolutely no hope. Now, is it possible at all to load a world of knowledge or instructional material on ancient wisdom onto the present syllabi? I'm afraid that is not possible at all. Because the syllabi are loaded. Because education today is haggardened by what I call the quantitative fallacy. We believe that competence is equal to the amount of information that we deposit into the brain of the student. Allow me to make a reference at this point in time to Swami Vivekananda, who has been one of the similar influences on me. He says, do not confuse education with the importing of knowledge, undigested, ill-assimilated, in a chaotic form, which remains in that fashion till the end of the life of the student. He says, education is the man-making, character-building, values-building assimilation of ideas, and then goes on to say that a person who has assimilated 5 ideas is far more educated than a person who has the entire library of the world by rote in his mind. Now, it is this process that we have lost sight of. So, unless and until we change our approach, our understanding, our practice of education, this integration that I've been talking about may not really become possible. And unless and until a framework is created for it. Now, if this integration is to take place, please understand that education is a process that is continually influenced by what happens in the society. So, at a time when education is completely market-ridden and the skills that are sought to be imparted to education are custom-made to meet the requirements of the market and market alone, there's a huge challenge, there's a huge hindrance to this very timely project of creating sane, healthy, creative, balanced human beings through the integration of modern knowledge and ancient wisdom. I have undertaken a few experiments in this during my tenure as a principal of the college, because I am someone who is intensely unhappy, miserable with the existing paradigm of higher education. Time doesn't permit me to go into this. I must respect the restrictions imposed on us, and we have a far better speaker coming after me. I'll pause here for the time being, and if there are questions pertaining to anything that I have said so far, I'll be happy to deal with it when the time comes. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, panelists and guests. Much has been said by both Mani Rao and Mr. Valson. I probably would draw from what both of them have said and would like to make three essential STEM statements from wherein I would try and develop the possibilities of integration. Integration of wisdom and knowledge, or the other way around. I agree with what Mr. Valson said about knowledge being continuous with wisdom. Knowledge and wisdom are continuous with one another. In fact, I am of the opinion that knowledge evolves into wisdom. It is not that wisdom is kind of accumulated as wisdom alone. It's not standalone wisdom that is accumulated or acquired. It is that knowledge evolves into wisdom, and one major factor that makes this evolution possible is experience. So over the course of time, knowledge with experience adding on to its dimensions would evolve into wisdom. And education should address the factor of self. When I say self here, with due respects, I do not mean the realization of self as was given by Mr. Valson. Of course, the ancient wisdom talks of self-realization, atma-sakshakaram, and so on. But in the modern context, I feel education will have to address the factor of self, identify the individual with all the strengths and limitations possible, and identify being a human. When I say self, it is that human self that will have to be emphasized upon. Now with this, with the three basic statements, I would say the way to integrate knowledge and wisdom, step one, be informed, and step two, analyze, step three, recognize the possible areas of integration. I would like to draw some examples from my own field of medicine. Now, in the ancient scriptures of this country, there are certain descriptions about an embryo. Now, I'm taking on the other side modern knowledge. I'm taking the knowledge of embryology, which is advancing day by day. An area of modern knowledge which does not stay modern even for a few hours. Maybe at the next hour you get something more advanced. The scriptures give a description of an embryo. Now there's one very, very clear classic description in the Bhagavatam. It says when Kapila is talking to his mother, Devahuti, 5 days from the time of the male and the female eggs come together, the egg and the sperm coming together, 5 days hence, the embryo would be a flat disc. Now, I read this information. You call it whatever you want. Maybe it's not classical ancient wisdom, but then it's somewhere there. And from my knowledge in medicine, my knowledge in embryology, I know somewhere around the fourth day onwards, the developing embryo is in the form of a disc. Maybe the names vary. We call it the bilaminar disc, the trilaminar disc, the germ disc, and so on. Now, if I try to bridge both these pieces of information, and where are those details of the cells? Where are those details of what layer of the disc is on top and what layer of the disc is below? That would not be bridging. That would be a futile effort. All that probably I would want to do, or I should do, is understand the concept. Yes, there had been some concept of this kind, and maybe use the modern technology or the technical know-how with prudent maturity. That is where the integration is required. I do not think integration is required to kind of, you know, verbatim try and find out that there is everything here and everything there, not have a real bridge across, but then use the information, have the information with no prejudice, no romance, as Mani said, but then have the information, analyze the information for the sake of developing prudent maturity in application of this wisdom. Now, yet another example which I would draw once again from my own field. In the morning when Mani Rao was talking to me, she was referring to Sushruta Samhita and the Charaka Samhita. Now, it is very, very essential to understand the principles which were laid down by experts like Sushruta. And if I try and use whatever they did in my modern surgery, I would be a failure. Now, I would give you a very, very mundane kind of example, not go into the scriptures deep there. Sushruta is often hailed the father of cosmetic surgery. Yes, true, he was. And if any of you had seen those pictures which we have kind of formulated for depicting Sushruta and his surgery, you would notice he would normally be performing a surgery in this area of the face, somewhere related to the root of the nose. The root of the nose, and he is supposed to have performed cosmetic surgeries wherein he took part of the skin of the forehead, turned it, reconstructed, mutilated nose. That is what the Sushruta Samhita talks about in detail. I've always wondered as to why was Sushruta all the time obsessed with reconstructing the nose. Why is it that Indians did not have a good nose, or maybe they had mutilated nose, and why is it that Sushruta was involved in this kind of a cosmetic work? Like, you know, unless you have a demand, the necessity to develop a technique would not have been there. But then when I read deep into history later on, I understood this country had the kind of a culture, you know, if you wanted to put somebody to shame, one way of doing it was to mutilate part of the face. You know, in Tamil we normally say, Mohatta kondu poi yenga vechikarudhu. You know, if your face is mutilated, not you know, leave it, physically not mutilated, but then you suffer some kind of a shame, your immediate response is, how would I face somebody? And this was kind of, you know, put into use the other way around. And that is why you find Lakshmana mutilating the nose of Surpanaka and so on. And even Krishna mutilating Rukmi in some way when he had to marry Rukmini. And then I also read that there were battles, wars. You know, one of the South Indian wars has been recorded in history as the Mukarupur. It was a war between the Madurai kingdom, the kingdom of the Nayaks, Madurai Nayak kingdom, and the Mysore Samstan. And this war is recorded as the Mukarupur in the time of Tirumalai Nayak. And what did they do? The warriors of one side went to the camp of the other side early in the morning, maybe in the wee hours, and then cut the noses of those warriors who were sleeping. So there was a kind of a demand where Sushruta probably had to develop a technique of bringing in the flap from the forehead and reconstruct the nose. But then, if I try and take this information, try and bring in this information to modern practice of cosmetic surgery, my emphasis would be to find out if the flap from here could be rotated and brought down, there should be a good blood supply to this area. If the blood supply is not good, whatever you rotate and keep here will not survive. So it is very essential that I take this, maybe not bit of wisdom, but then piece of information from ancient wisdom, and try and develop how best this vasculature could be identified, how best the blood supply to this flap could be identified, and how best the flap could be made larger or put into use. So that is where I think the knowledge, the modern knowledge or the modern technical know-how will have to develop in the lines of ancient wisdom, use it with prudent maturity, evolve into the same wisdom and make it more expansile and inclusive. I'm not kind of treading into those areas wherein Mr. Valson was treading, like if at all there is a necessity to bridge knowledge and wisdom. I don't think there is a necessity to bridge knowledge and wisdom, but there is absolutely a necessity to evolve knowledge into what should go near wisdom. Probably not wisdom totally, but then somewhere near wisdom, this knowledge will have to evolve. With that, I'll close for now, and then we'll take questions as they come.
Actually, before we open to the audience with questions, a couple of questions I have, I would love to ask, and I really appreciate, Dr. Sudha, that you answered the question I had in the morning, which is how do you work with something like that, like an ancient source, and who decides, and, you know, applicability. I thank you for weaving that in. My question is that we're talking about the Indian corpus, because, you know, the theme of the conference is also about Indianization of Indian education. And to some extent, I suppose the questions that are raised in this conclave are about the educational system, the formal educational system. Whereas all three of us have talked about the topic in more general terms. When you talk about early Indian sources, there is a lot more than just realization related information, right? We have Jyotish, we have prosody, we have medical sciences, and then you go, you know, there's a Shilpa Shastra, there's dance, there's Natya Shastra, there's a rich resource which sort of has a question hanging around it about relevance when it comes to marketability or monetization and so on, right? And until it gets monetized, then it becomes a fashion or whatever. So the question I have is, can these subjects be integrated into their modern avatars? For example, when students study literature, could Natyashastra be a part of that? Could students of law also study early, legal methodology? Can they understand how the principles of Purva Mimamsa actually have been applied onto Dharmashastras? You know, how is such an integration actually possible formally? Would you have?
Or one aspect of experience in relation to the whole. Either way, there's a spotlight on the whole. Now, the problem is, and this is where knowledge and wisdom parted company. See, for practical reasons, we held on to knowledge, which is extremely limited, not realizing that this embracement of the partial will actually cripple us in the development of our humanity and personality, as a result of which, to quote again Eliot, we are stuffed men, hollow men. Now, the sense of being alive is not there in us. And I believe that is a huge cultural loss for a whole generation, for a whole nation, to be reduced to the level of what existential philosophers call sub-men. Sub-men, that's a technical term they use. Sub-men. Now, I asked myself a question today, which is slightly outside our range. What is it that fascinates somebody like Prime Minister, the people of India? We say we somebody like Prime Minister Modi. I'm an admirer of Modi, I can tell you. I don't agree with his policies or his priorities. That's a different matter. But the man fascinates me because there is that touch of aliveness in him. And that would not have stood out except for the fact that a vast majority of people in this country are mere shadows. And who created the shadows? The education system created the shadows. And therefore, there is, we must emphasize this, there is a case to be made to first of all go back to our roots, because after all, roots matter. Without roots, there can be no fruits. It's as simple as that. My running quarrel with the existing system is that the present practice of higher education virtually cuts us off our roots from ourselves. We're getting alienated from ourselves through this modern education. Now, modern education can be redeemed through a proper adaptation of its molds and material from a particular paradigm, which is what we refuse to create. Now, unless and until the colonial hangover departs from us and we begin to believe that there is something good in us. There is no culture in the world which does not have something incomparably good within itself. But we have been brainwashed and indoctrinated and culturally emaciated to believe that we are inferior people and therefore all solutions will come from the West. And ultimately, today, we have only one God. We are fighting in vain about gods. I tell you today, there's only one God, and that God is technology. All other gods fade into insignificance in the face of the modern God called technology.
I hope you don't mind if I just redirect our conversation back to what we're doing.
I'm sorry, I got carried away.
So it sounds like you agree that that there should be integration of the ancient information into specialized current learning.
Mani, probably as you rightly said, literature, there could be an integration of the associated areas. I would say this associated area would keep on, like, you know, it would become more and more expansile. And at the end of it, you find somebody who has an exposure to such things matures better. You know, even if it's literature, the individual matures better with the knowledge of literature when he or she has an exposure to the associated areas.
So then that really takes us to the next question about this whole sort of, I would say, some kind of debate, controversy, or even a battle about who is the stakeholder for such decisions, whether or not the educational, those kind of decisions should be sort of led by governmental organizations. Is it universities that can take those steps? And the second question is, how do you separate the Indian from the sort of the religious, you know, labeling of a lot of ancient information, which gets, I will say, hijacked also by those connotations, and then ideology becomes sort of the driving force rather than the focus on the learning itself. Do you think educational institutions should be influenced by any of that? And who is
to answer the first part of your question, like who is to take steps or who is to bell the cat, right? As simple as that. Probably it's not one agency that would have to do that. We've gone so much into the present system of chaotic education that it's not possible for one agency to do that. Maybe it would have to be a perfect blend of all the agencies coming together, the government, the universities, the schools, the authorities, the people who are apparently outside the realm of education, people who maybe, you know, thinkers, philosophers, who may not be directly involved in education, but then it's the responsibility of bringing up a good generation, a future generation. So I think all agencies will have to come together.
Now, I know that you're wanting to say something, but I'm going to have to give you 2 minutes only on this one.
Sorry. I haven't cultivated the sweetness of brevity. This is a question that's addressed up front by one of the major thinkers on education in the 20th century. His name is John Dewey, around first decade of the last century. He says, look, education is a highly specialized field. At the same time, it's a social project. It's not only a social project, but it's also a state-funded activity. That's where the complication lies. And it's quite natural that the funding source, the funding agency, wants to control it. So throughout the history of education, you see the state butting in big time into the agenda of education. The further temptation for the state to meddle with education without having the know-how, the grounding in education, which makes it dangerous, is that education is the most deeply formative activity in a society. Education is a process of building the society that you want to live in tomorrow. Therefore, from a political angle, the temptation is irresistible to penetrate and colonize education so that its influence spreads deep into it. But in practical terms, and I'll be brief, don't worry, in practical terms, the real issue, if I bring it down, bring this issue down to one particular factor, it is the politicization of education through appointments. Unfortunately, I have to say this, that almost every appointment of vice chancellors today is a political appointment. And no greater disservice can be done to education than this, because then their heart is not with education, it is with the duty to please the master by making suitable noises. In the process, the entire culture of learning in a university suffers.
With that, we can open up for questions. I think we have probably 10 minutes. We've been so thorough, there are no questions.
Sir, a question to Mr. Thampu. This is Professor Agotman from Radharakshma Engineering College. Sir, this British Christian Raj destroyed our ancient education, sir. I have small doubt. We don't want Hindi, we don't want Sanskrit. Then what we are going to do, sir, further?
I will have to differ from you, from us, from the sense of history. Actually, it was the British East India Company that did not want Western education to spread in this country because they feared that the liberating modern ideals that modern education would spread in the Indian society would spell the doom for the domination of the company over India. They were quite happy to promote the Sanskrit education because they felt that that was pretty safe. I must say that it's actually the leaders of the nationalist leaders of our liberation movement who insisted on the spread of Western education in this country, which I can understand at that point in time was important. Now, if you read Bankim Chandra Chatterjee's Anandamath, for example, the epilogue is a very interesting piece of document. He very clearly says that the departure of the British at this point in time would be premature because we still have to absorb a lot of knowledge and strength from them. Therefore, the time is not yet. So you must understand that there is a tendency to simplify history to suit certain ideological purposes. And this is nothing but the public display of knowledge. It's a caricature of history. It doesn't really help anyone. Now, if you really look into the history of the mission activities in education, you find that all missionary movements, my college is a product of missionary movement, all missionary movements started institutions as a meeting point between the East and the West, and they had a particular emphasis on developing the local language. The first printing press in Kerala was set up by British missionaries in 1811. The government of Kerala set up its printing mission, printing unit, only 30 years thereafter. The first translation from Malayalam to English took place through a missionary. Malayalam grammar was codified by British missionaries. Malayalam language was promoted by them. Education was taken to the four corners of Kerala by them. This has happened all throughout. If you read the Tagore report of 1954, which was appointed to investigate into the allegations against missionary involvement in the state of Madhya Pradesh, you will come across a statement by a group that was hostile to the missionary movement. They said that but for the missionary activities in Madhya Pradesh, these people who otherwise would have been unreached would have remained in a primitive state. So I think we need to be factually, historically correct in arriving at our positions. There is absolutely no evidence of the British education as practiced by the missionaries. I'm not holding a brief of the East India Company or the British Raj. I'm talking about the British missionaries ever having belittled or attempted to constrict or limit the local culture, local knowledge, or local aspirations. In fact, they served as a catalyst for all of them, as a fact in history.
Thank you. That was a really elaborate and a wonderful explanation that you gave us. And ladies and gentlemen, that leaves us no time for any further questions. A big hand to our panelists. I think I certainly learned a lot. More than I had an opinion on this particular topic, I learned so much. So thank you for enlightening us and taking us through this wonderful topic. Thank you very, very much. May I request Mr. Prabhu Chavla to kindly join us on to felicitate the panelists.
Hello, the ladies first.
I tell you, gentlemen. a quick group photo opportunity.
I got a lecture on VD. I didn't know such thing then.
I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was great.
Thank you for giving us an opportunity to look at something that we can probably research upon after this discussion. Thank you very much.